So good evening everyone, this is Dr. Vineet Sehgal and welcome to the next session of the clinical case discussion for the third year students. And today we would be starting with our next topic, that is the endophthalmitis. So endophthalmitis, one of the most dreaded complication of any intraocular surgery, is the last thing that a surgeon would basically like in its life. So this, as a long case or as a short case, can be basically put in your exam, but whenever you are getting a case of endophthalmitis, so remember, this is the easiest one which can be put. So because why I would say that the endophthalmitis is the easiest one, because all the findings that you get in the endophthalmitis is just the combination of the findings that you see in a patient of, let's say, corneal ulcer or anterior uveitis. Only thing that can be asked more in your viva exam is regarding the management of the patient. And this is a very important topic when it comes to your NEET PG exam. So this clinical case discussion, we would basically make it like a story. Okay, so I would start it where, let's say that the patient has come to your clinic and now you have diagnosed the patient or you are suspecting the endophthalmitis. What can be the other provisional diagnosis? What can be the other differential diagnosis? What is the investigation of choice to basically see the endophthalmitis? And how would you treat this patient of endophthalmitis, that we would discuss today. Okay, so myself, Dr. Vineet Sehgal, you can see all my lectures exclusively on the Unacademy Learning app. And if you are very serious for your preparation, go with the plus subscription, where you would have added advantage of the daily live classes, live tests and quizzes. There is a structured schedule which is going on and the unlimited access to the video lectures. So I start with our session, and whenever you have a case, you have to basically define the case or proceed in the case with the following headings. You tell about the demographic profile of the patient. Let's say, what is the age, what is the sex, what is the address of the patient. After this, you come to the chief complaints. After the chief complaints, you go into the history. In the history, you talk about the history of the present illness, where you would describe the chief complaints. You would talk about history of any past illness. You would talk about the personal history and the family history of the patient, if that is relevant. After this, you come to the general examination. After the general examination, you come to the ocular examination, followed by what is your provisional diagnosis and what can be your differential diagnosis. After this, you go into the investigation, followed by the management. So this should be your protocol whenever you are thinking that the patient may be having a long case and an endophthalmitis. Okay, so first of all, let's say a patient has come to you and this patient is a young patient, okay, and you are suspecting a endophthalmitis, or if the patient is a old age patient and you are suspecting a endophthalmitis. So what is the difference between that? So if a young patient has come with the endophthalmitis, you ask the patient that, is there any history of any immunosuppression in the patient? Is the patient HIV positive or any other disease the patient is having? You talk about any intraocular surgery to this patient also. If the patient is an old age patient, the first thing that you would basically see, let's say the patient is a 65 year old patient, the first thing that comes into your mind is that whether this patient has got an intraocular cataract surgery done, because the intraocular cataract surgery is most common cause of endophthalmitis. So if they ask in your viva, what is the most common cause of the endophthalmitis? So it is post intraocular surgery. And which surgery is most commonly responsible? It is your cataract surgery. Okay. Now after going this, then you have to go with the chief complaints. The chief complaints, as I have told you in the uveitis, they are the same. You can have pain, redness, discharge, diminution of vision, and you can also have halos. Like I told you when I talked about the long case of uveitis. Remember, whenever you talk about the chief complaints, also mention the duration, and the basic thing is go in a decreasing order. So you can say that the patient is having a severe pain for 5 days, redness for 4 days, diminution of vision for 3 days, and discharge from last 3 days. Okay. So in this way, what you go is that you tell the patient, you tell the examiner the most important chief complaint, and then you basically go to the other ones. So remember, every complaint, they can ask you a question. So as soon as you say that the patient is having a pain, so they would ask you, can patient have a loss of vision where there is no pain? So answer is yes. So if they ask a question like this, what are the various causes of painless loss of vision? Can anyone of you tell answer? So if they ask about the painless loss of vision, then the chances like CRAO, okay, or even arteritic AION, massive retinal detachment. So they all can be causes of painless loss of vision. Okay, whenever we talk about endophthalmitis or we talk about uveitis, these are the causes of painful loss of vision. Then they would ask, you would say redness. So they would ask which type of redness it can be. Is it a superficial redness? Is there a deep redness? Or is there a circumcorneal congestion? So you see around the cornea, if you feel that there are vessels like this, reddish vessels like this, so this is basically a circumcorneal congestion. So you would say that, sir, the patient is having a circumcorneal congestion. So as soon as you say that the patient is having a circumcorneal congestion, the next question the examiner can ask is, are there any other causes of circumcorneal congestion? So you would say, yes, the other causes of circumcorneal congestion can be uveitis, keratitis, and even angle closure glaucomas. Okay, then you would say discharge. As soon as you say discharge, the examiner would ask you which type of discharge. So you would say either serous. So serous is a watery discharge, or the discharge is mucoid, okay, or mucopurulent, which is more a characteristic of a discharge, which is a bacterial discharge. Okay, so after this, after you have put the chief complaint, the next thing that you have to write in your case sheet is the history of present illness. So in the history of present illness, what you have to do is you have to basically elaborate your findings. Okay, you have to elaborate your chief complaints in the history of your present illness. So you would first tell about the onset of symptoms. So you would say it like this, that, sir, the patient has come to the OPD. He says that he is having the redness in the eye for last 4 days. He noticed this redness when he basically went to, let's say, read a newspaper, or he went for a washroom and he saw his eyes on the mirror. There he saw that he has redness in the eye. Or if the patient says that, sir, the patient presented with the pain, this pain was so much that he basically got up in the morning, early morning, and he was very uncomfortable and he took a paracetamol or a brufen for relieving the pain. Similarly, you have to define how is the blurring of vision, whether it was a gradual onset that slowly and slowly the vision was decreasing, or when he got up from the bed, he was having a total loss of vision. Similarly, as I told you, the redness, you have to define it. You have to tell the type of discharge, how much discharge is there. Always remember, whenever the patient is having an endophthalmitis, this patient would have a lot of uveitis component as well. So the patient would have a photophobia as well. If this patient is having the endophthalmitis after a surgery or trauma, you have to elaborate the surgery that has taken place or the trauma that has taken place also. So let's say the endophthalmitis is after a trabeculectomy surgery. So you would say that, sir, the patient had undergone a trabeculectomy surgery 3 years back, and now the patient has got a decrease in vision. Okay, or if the patient is having a corneal perforation, you have to basically tell about that also. Okay, or if the patient has got a intracorneal foreign body, or if the patient was having a conjunctival foreign body, whether it is a relevant or not relevant, you have to basically tell it in your case sheet to your examiner. Then, as I told you, history of past illness. If the patient is having a intraocular surgery, you have to define that, you have to describe that. Also, very, very important is that sometimes some complications during the intraocular surgery. For an example, I say that there is a posterior capsular rupture. There is a posterior capsule rupture during the intraocular surgery. So if that has happened, you have to mention it. So why this is important? Because this complication is basically a risk factor for intraocular surgery. Then, as I told you, you have to describe the trauma, and if the patient is on the immunosuppressants or the condition of the patient is something where you see that the immunosuppression can basically play a role, you have to tell that. Okay, then we come to the next point, which is the personal history. In the personal history, the most important ones is that you have to basically tell about the diabetes, the sugar control, as well as, very, very important is, don't miss it, if the patient is having a renal disorder. Let's say patient is on dialysis. So dialysis patient itself, there are chances that the patient may go into the endogenous endophthalmitis. Okay, so there are two types of endophthalmitis. There is a endogenous, and where the infection source is inside the body, and there can be exogenous, where a trauma or let's say a surgery, a intraocular surgery, has basically introduced the bacteria or the pathogen inside the eye. Okay, also if the patient is in the high risk group, okay, these patients are more vulnerable to the HIV, and HIV itself is something which is a immunosuppressive condition. These patients are also more vulnerable to endophthalmitis. You have to basically tell it in your case sheet. Then we come to the general examination. In the general examination, you have to tell about the age, build and nutritional status of the patient. Nothing much to describe here. Then comes your ocular examination. So in ocular examination, you have to see the eyelids. I call it ocular adnexa. Go to the conjunctiva. Then go to the cornea, sclera. If there is a scleral wound of a small incision cataract surgery, or if there is a bleb made of a trabeculectomy surgery, you have to mention that. And then you go to the anterior chamber and tell about the findings, whether the patient is having a iritis, the patient is having a uveitis, if the patient is having a posterior synechia, you have to define that. Followed that, you have to tell about the status of lens, whether the patient is a phakic patient or the patient is a aphakic patient, or if the patient is a pseudophakic patient. Remember, the word pseudophakia means the patient has got a intraocular lens. In the posterior segment, usually it is not visible. So if it is not visible, you have to write it that the posterior segment was not visible because of the corneal edema or the uveitis or the vitreous haze. Okay, so very, very important is that in the ocular examination, you see and tell about the all the findings there. Now, what can be the question? So you would ask me, sir, why the eyelid is important? In the eyelid, if you can see in this patient, the patient is having the, can you see these around the posterior part of your eyelid, this yellowish material coming out from these openings. So this is basically a patient who is having a meibomian gland disorder. Now these meibomian glands, if they get infected, I call it meibomitis. So if the patient is having a meibomitis, or in the ocular adnexa, if the patient is having a decreocystitis. So what this causes, they are basically source of infection. So after a cataract surgery, the bacteria or microorganisms from the lacrimal sac or from the meibomian gland, they can go inside and cause the infection inside the eye. They can cause the endophthalmitis. So you have to write it about that. Then you can see this is the congestion, the red eye. So whenever you see the red eye, you have to tell whether it is a superficial, it is a deep, it is a circumcorneal. So just read about the differential diagnosis of the red eye that I have seen, I have told you in my previous sessions. Those students who have just joined now, I would just tell you that this clinical case discussion series, this I am taking it on the Let's Crack Neet PG YouTube channel. And if you are subscribing for the Unacademy Plus program, there are four sessions which are starting from tomorrow. The Neet PG Season 1 batch on the 5th of May, INICT MCQ Marathon batch from 5th of May, Target Next 2022 batch, and the FMG Test and Analysis batch. These all batches you can basically subscribe when you subscribe for the Unacademy Plus program. Okay, with this, the next thing that you have to see is about the cornea. Sometimes because of this infection, you can have a corneal edema. Also sometimes the corneal ulcer, the most probably the corneal ulcers where the bacteria that can basically penetrate the intact cornea, like Corynebacterium diphtheriae, like Neisseria gonorrhoeae, like Neisseria meningitis. So what these are doing is that they are basically penetrating the intact cornea. So even if there is no perforation, they can go inside and cause a endophthalmitis. So if there is a corneal ulcer, you have to mention what is the type of corneal ulcer, how much is the size of the corneal ulcer, where is the position of the corneal ulcer, and what do you think that the patient may be suffering from. Okay, with this, if the patient is having a condition like this, this is called conjunctival bleb. Whenever you are having a conjunctival bleb, why it is important for you? Because if you can see, there are no vascularization here. So there is no vascularization here. This patient is having a avascular bleb. Now here the examiner may ask you, if you are having a avascular bleb after a trabeculectomy surgery, what is the drug that is suspected to have been used to augment the functioning of the bleb or to reduce the amount of fibrosis? Can anyone answer? So aisi kaun si cheez hum use karte hain during a trabeculectomy surgery jo ki fibrosis ko reduce karti hai aur ek bleb ko avascular banati hai. So this is also a risk factor for bleb related endophthalmitis. And name of the agent is, have you ever heard the name? Mitomycin C. So if the patient has undergone a trabeculectomy surgery with mitomycin C, this is itself a risk factor. Whenever you have an endophthalmitis, a very, very important finding is this one. This finding is basically called pus in the anterior chamber, and I call it hypopyon. As soon as you say hypopyon, the examiner may ask you that what are the other causes of hypopyon. One is your endophthalmitis. So you would say that, sir, it can happen in corneal ulcer. It can also happen in the patients with uveitis. Do not confuse a hypopyon with a hyphema. Whenever the patient is having a hyphema, that is basically blood in the anterior chamber. Okay, so with this, the examiner would ask you what are the various differential diagnoses you can say. So if you are seeing this picture, so you would say that, sir, this patient may be having a corneal ulcer. Okay, because if the patient is having a corneal ulcer, here also the patient can have hypopyon, the patient can have congestion, the patient can have non-visualization of the fundus. Do you all agree? So corneal ulcer ho sakta hai, hame kaise pata ki endophthalmitis hai. Second thing is, we can have a uveitis also. Okay, uveitis can also present with these type of features like we are getting in endophthalmitis. And third is toxic anterior segment syndrome. I would tell you about toxic anterior segment syndrome when I would end the session. Till now, just read it, that this can be also a very important differential diagnosis. Then we come to what are the general investigations that you would do. So as I told you, endophthalmitis can be a exogenous endophthalmitis or it can be an endogenous endophthalmitis. So in these patients, you always have to basically rule out any source of infection. You also have to rule out any immunosuppression, and you also have to rule out any invasive surgery that has been taken either in the eye or in the body. So for the general investigations, the first and the most important thing that I would do is I would do a blood sugar. I would do a fasting blood sugar. I would do a PPBS. I would do a glycosylated hemoglobin if the patient is a diabetic. With this, I would also go with a complete blood culture with ESR. I would see that if there is something which is basically going on inside the eye which has caused this. So patient may have got a non-complicated, uncomplicated cataract surgery, still the patient has got an endophthalmitis. So we have to rule out that there may not be any systemic nidus of infection. With this, I would also do a blood culture, a urine routine and microscopy, and I would do the triple test if I suspect a patient is having an endogenous endophthalmitis and my patient is IV drug abuser. So I would go with a HIV test also there. Then the question they ask so many times, yes, you cannot see the posterior segment. So to see the posterior segment, what is the investigation that you would try to do in these patients? So the investigation that I would try in these patients would be the ultrasound. I call it USG B scan. If you can see here in this picture, there is a vitreous haze. Okay. So there, and here you can see some small mild amplitude spikes also. These are called A scan and this is called B scan. A scan you are having amplitude spikes and B scan you are having a vitreous haze. And whenever you are having a vitreous haze, this means that something fishy is going on. The patient may be having an endophthalmitis. Okay. So these mild to moderate amplitude spikes in the vitreous cavity, where the patient has got infection inside the anterior chamber, this confirms your diagnosis of endophthalmitis. Give me a thumbs up if you are able to understand the point. Okay, so investigation of choice kya karni hai? Hume endophthalmitis mein humko B scan karna. So next thing is, now the examiner would ask you, let's say the patient has got with a endophthalmitis, how would you treat the patient? So as I told you, first of all, I would just show you how the B scan is done. So can you see, this is the probe. Usually it is done in a dark room and the patient is supine. But just for the video, I have basically put the patient in the sitting position. So you can see I am putting the probe over the closed eyelids. Okay. And then I am seeing its image here in this screen. Okay, this is a USG B scan which is going on. Okay, so with this, the empirical treatment that you would start before you confirm the diagnosis is definitely, because it can be infective, you start with the fortified concentrated antibiotics like you do it in your patients of corneal ulcer. You start with the cefazolin 5% and 1.3% dobramycin eye drops. Concentrated and fortified. What is the meaning of the word fortified antibiotics? Fortified means that they are freshly prepared with the antibiotic powder, so they have the higher efficacy. And the second thing is that these antibiotics are preservative free. Because the patient is having a uveitis, so I would definitely start with the cycloplegics. These patients may have a high intraocular pressure, so I would also start with the anti-glaucoma medications. The two anti-glaucoma medications I would avoid in these patients would be PG analogs, and I would avoid pilocarpine. The reason is they both can exacerbate the inflammation part. Okay, so I would basically avoid both of these anti-glaucoma medications. Then comes what is the definite treatment. So definite treatment in these patients is intravitreal antibiotics. I would just show you how the intravitreal antibiotics are put. So if you can see in this picture, so 4 millimeter from the limbus, okay, we have marked 4 millimeter from the limbus, and with a 30 gauge needle there in a syringe loaded with the intravitreal antibiotics, I am going into the vitreous cavity and injecting the intravitreal antibiotics inside. Okay, I repeat it once again. You can see 4 millimeter from the limbus, we are going inside. Okay, with a 30 gauge needle on a syringe with the intravitreal antibiotics, I push it inside the vitreous cavity. Now, this is the first thing that I would do in my patients of endophthalmitis. If the patient is still not resolving, even after getting the multiple intravitreal antibiotics, then I have to go with the second option, that is the pars plana vitrectomy. So what are the indications of doing a pars plana vitrectomy? I write it here. If the patient is not improving, or he is deteriorating, or when the patient presents with a very bad vision, let's say the patient vision is hand movement close to face. So this is such a low vision that in these cases, we cannot even wait for the intravitreal antibiotics to basically act. I have to go with the invasive surgery, remove all the infective content of the vitreous, and then I can put a gas or a oil inside the vitreous cavity. I would just show you how we do a vitrectomy. So if you can see, this is not for the end of, but you can just see here. So we go inside the vitreous cavity with our probes. One is an illuminator and other is a cutter. Then we cut the vitreous, and after cutting the vitreous, what we do is we aspirate the vitreous. If there is a hole, there is something which is a suspicious lesion, we can laser it also. So laser is also available inside with this vitrectomy machines, and we can basically do that also. We regularly do it in the patients who are having a tractional retinal detachment or a chronic retinal detachment. So what is this surgery? This surgery is a vitrectomy surgery going on. Okay, so after doing a vitrectomy surgery, the patient usually improves, and this is the something which is the final treatment. But we have to do everything as soon as possible, because if we delay the treatment, this can cause the microorganisms inside the vitreous cavity, they can basically go over the retina and can permanently damage the retinal cells. So you can have a permanent damage. So endophthalmitis is something which is a very, very ocular, very, very serious condition, and it is considered as an ocular emergency. So second thing that the examiner may ask you, what are the other ocular emergencies that you know? So the other ocular emergencies can be regmatogenous retinal detachment. You can have a primary angle closure glaucoma. You can have a corneal perforation. Okay. Or you can have a central retinal artery occlusion, ocular ischemic syndromes. So these are the other ocular emergencies where you have to treat the patient as soon as possible. If you do an intravitreal injection or you do a pars plana vitrectomy, if you get some vitreous exudate, this you can send it for the culture and sensitivity, and according to the sensitivity, you can start the new antibiotics there. Okay. Now remember, there can be few questions which are the MCQ based questions which can be also asked from you. So the first is, what is the most common cause of endophthalmitis? Can anyone tell me? So my question is, which is the most common bacteria which is causing the endophthalmitis? Our favorite, that is Staphylococcus. Okay, Staph epidermidis. It has been seen in the patients of the endophthalmitis. Okay, second is, most common bacterial cause post trauma. So here remember, it is Bacillus cereus. If we ask most common cause in HIV positive or immunosuppressant patients, then your answer is Candida. If they ask most common cause in post YAC capsulotomy patients, then your answer is Propionibacterium acnes. Okay, so these are few important one-liners which can be asked in your exam. Okay, so then we have, what is the prophylaxis of this catastrophic disease? So sometimes patients ask that do we need to take oral antibiotics, do we need to have topical antibiotics or all these before the surgery. So only two established methods which can prevent the endophthalmitis. The first is good scrubbing of the surgeon. Okay, before the surgery you have the 9 steps which you do for the hand cleaning. So I call scrub of the surgeon, okay, with the betadine. This has to be done, and proper sterilization of the instruments. There is no role of topical or oral antibiotics, though they are usually given preoperatively, but they do not have a definite role in a cataract surgery. Okay, then we have the question for you, that is there a role of systemic antibiotics in treatment of the endophthalmitis? Remember, they do not have a role in the preoperative. Okay, so preoperatively they do not have a role. My question is, do they have a role in the treatment of endophthalmitis? Yes or no? I am asking about systemic antibiotics. So the answer here also is no. They do not have any role even in the treatment of endophthalmitis, because the penetration of the oral or the systemic antibiotics in the vitreous cavity is very low. So you have to go with the intravitreal injections in these patients. Okay, then we have the next thing, next important topic, which is TAS. Now what is TAS? So many times the examiner asks, what is TAS? TAS is basically called toxic anterior segment syndrome. Toxic anterior segment syndrome. So what is actually a TAS? Like your endophthalmitis, you may be having a corneal edema in both the TAS and endophthalmitis, but as the name suggests, remember, endophthalmitis is basically defined as the infectious condition which has basically involved the vitreous cavity. Okay, but remember, in the toxic anterior segment syndrome, the posterior segment is not involved. Okay, so I write the posterior segment is not involved here. You may be having a hypopyon because of the anterior segment inflammation, but very, very important is that there is no vitreous exudate. It is not infectious. Why it is happening? Because of the hypersensitivity to the instruments that are used in the surgery, or due to the hypersensitivity of the agents that are used in the surgery. Let's say we have put viscoelastics inside the anterior chamber. Let's say we are using some agents inside the cavity, in agents for basically fumigation, which has basically gone inside the eye and they have caused a hypersensitivity reaction of the uveal tissue. Okay, so because this is something which is an infectious cause, so they are not responding to the steroids. So they are responding to the steroids, but in the endophthalmitis, this is an infectious condition, so they do not respond to the steroid. So TAS, I again tell you, is a toxic anterior segment syndrome, where there is a hypersensitivity of the anterior segment to the variety of the agents and the instruments used in the surgery. The patient comes with the corneal edema and there can be a hypopyon, but there are no posterior segment involvement. There is no vitreous exudates. The B scan is totally clear and the patient is not having any infection. So these patients usually respond to the steroids. The endophthalmitis have the vitreous exudates. They are infectious and they do not respond to the steroids. Okay. So with this, I end my session of the endophthalmitis. Before we basically end this session, I have few very important MCQs for that. Just try to answer it in the comment section. So my first MCQ to you is, not a sign of endophthalmitis. Try to answer. Hypopyon, vitreous inflammation, I call it vitritis, iritis or optic neuritis. So optic neuritis is not the sign of endophthalmitis. Okay, hypopyon, as I told you. So those students who have just joined now, this is how the hypopyon looks like. It is the pus in the anterior chamber. Okay, let's move to our next question. The next question is investigation of choice. So the question was not a sign. Okay, it is not sign of endophthalmitis. Question was not a sign of endophthalmitis. Okay, so the next question is investigation of choice for endophthalmitis. Your options are CT scan, vitreous biopsy, USGB scan, or MRI head and orbit. So endophthalmitis, which is the inflammation and the exudates infection of the vitreous cavity as well as the anterior segment is involved, usually you do which investigation to basically confirm your diagnosis? Try to answer, everyone. Ramandeep, Shishti. So the answer here is USG B scan. Okay, so if you can see here, this is the B scan where you are seeing mild to moderate amplitude spikes in the vitreous cavity. Okay, so this is the USG B. B goes for brightness scan. Okay, let's move to the next question. Not a management option for endophthalmitis. Your options are fortified topical antibiotics, cycloplegics, pars plana vitrectomy, or intravenous antibiotics. क्या चीज हम नहीं यूज करते हैं? आई जस्ट टोल्ड यू इन माई मैनेजमेंट स्लाइड्स राइट नाउ. सो इट इज योर इंट्रावेनस एंटीबायोटिक्स. रिमेंबर, इंट्रावेनस और सिस्टमिक एंटीबायोटिक्स और ओरल एंटीबायोटिक्स डज नॉट हैव एनी रोल आइदर इन द प्रोफाइलेक्सिस और इन द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ योर एंडोफ्थेलमाइटिस. वी डू नॉट यूज इंट्रावेनस, we use intravitreal antibiotics. Okay, very good, Dr. Ranjan. We use intravitreal antibiotics. Okay, then the last question is most common cause of endophthalmitis in post YAG capsulotomy patients is Staphylococcus epidermidis, Bacillus cereus, Propionibacterium and acnes, or Candida. So the answer here is, very good, Dr. Ragini, it is B, that is Propionibacterium acnes. If they ask about the agent which is the most common cause after trauma, then it is Bacillus cereus. And if they ask the most common cause in a immunosuppressant, then your answer is Candida. Okay. Then we have the next question, distance of the injection tip from the limbus in case of intravitreal injection in a pseudophakic patient should be 2 mm, 3 mm, 4 mm or 6 mm. So my question is, whenever we put the injection in the intravitreal cavity, what should be this distance? Let's say the patient is pseudophakic. Pseudophakic means the patient has undergone a cataract surgery. So I would just show you how the intravitreal, those students who have just joined now, see how the intravitreal injections are given. I am measuring it from the caliper and then I am putting the injection inside the vitreous cavity. The problem right now is that we do not have the exposure, at least for the third year students, for the wards. So if you want any videos, any practical scenarios, you can ask me. We would put the videos regarding that also. Okay. So this question, yes. So the answer here is C, that is 4 millimeter. Okay. Then we move to the next question. So patient presenting with the limbus to limbus corneal edema with iritis. Okay. On USG, it was anechoic and the patient responded to the steroid treatment. Okay. So there were no mild to moderate amplitude spikes. So he may be suffering from endophthalmitis, panophthalmitis, toxic anterior segment syndrome, or retinoblastoma. Try to answer. So here the patient is having a corneal edema with iritis. It can happen in endophthalmitis, it can happen in panophthalmitis, it can happen in toxic anterior segment syndrome, it can happen in retinoblastoma. So everyone and all these options can have the first sign. But the second thing is on USG, it was anechoic. Okay. So remember, in the endophthalmitis and panophthalmitis, you would be having a vitreous inflammation. So you would be having mild to moderate amplitude spikes there. Okay. So it would not be endophthalmitis. In the retinoblastoma also, you would be having specific mass lesion inside the vitreous cavity. So USG B scan would show a very dense spikes in these patients also. I would just show you how the retinoblastoma spikes look like. So if you can see here, if you can appreciate, this is a USG B scan where you can see very dense mass. See the spike. Compare it with the spikes that are I have showed you with the endophthalmitis. They were very small spikes. Here, these are very large spikes. So in the patients who are having a retinoblastoma, you have a very high spikes and this is not an anechoic lesion. Okay. And another hint that has given here that the patient responded very well to the steroid treatment, also telling that this patient is having a toxic anterior segment syndrome and it is not a retinoblastoma. Okay. So with this, I end my session. Hope you would have liked the session. So this is a clinical case discussion series that I am doing. Tomorrow also, I would be there with another important topic of the entropion and ectropion and the angle closure glaucoma. So see you tomorrow at 7:30 p.m. in the Let's Crack Neat PG channel. So hit the bell icon for notifications. And if you like the channel, like this video, if you want to see more of the video contents, just subscribe for us. And if you want to go with a 3-month subscription of Unacademy, you can get a 1-month subscription free of cost and you use Ophthal10 as a code to get a 10% discount on whatever course that you want. Okay. So with this, I end my session. Good night, Jai Hind, and take good care of yourself.